The cosmic distance ladder, also known as the extragalactic distance scale, is the succession of methods by which astronomers determine the distances to celestial objects. Let's suppose we are observing two stars in the night sky, and we are wondering which one is the most distant from us. This is not a simple question to answer. For example, if the two stars were lying at the same distance from us and had the same intrinsic luminosity, we would see them showing the same brightness. But what if one of them was more distant from us than the other? We would expect to detect a difference in brightness. The more distant a star is, the less bright it will appear in the sky. And that's exactly what we observe, apparent brightness. Since intrinsic luminosity provides us with a huge quantity of information about stars, their atmosphere, their surface temperature, and their radius, it has been worth it to spend a lot of effort in the computing of distances. Finally, when we observe the sky, we are seeing a two-dimensional space without any information about the third one. The stars that form constellations, they are in general separated in the depth dimension. Follow me on this journey to learn more about this topic and to understand how astronomers are measuring the distances in the universe, starting from the measure of astronomic unit until we get to the famous Hubble's Law. So now we know that if we want to understand the physics behind an astronomical phenomenon, we need to quantify the basic properties of the system under observation. Many of these properties cannot be determined unless we know the distance to the object in question. Although we are not able to determine many of the absolute properties of astronomical phenomena without distance information, we can compare their relative properties. For example, the stars in any galaxy outside our own are all at essentially the same distance from us. Thus, if observations of a nearby galaxy reveal that all the stars of a particular type have the same apparent brightness, then we know that this class of objects all have the same intrinsic luminosity. We can use this property to measure the relative distances to the other galaxies. If we can identify the same type of star in these galaxies and measure their apparent brightness, then the ratio distances follows directly from the ratio of apparent luminosity fluxes. Sources with identical intrinsic luminosities which can be used in this way are known as standard candles. Think about the procedure once again. The distance to a nearby galaxy might be determined by comparing the apparent brightness of its individual stars to those of similar stars in the Milky Way. The distance to a more remote galaxy whose individual stars cannot be resolved can then be measured by comparing the properties of the galaxy as a whole to the properties of the nearby galaxies, and so on. This bootstrapping approach has been dubbed the cosmic distance ladder, where each rung up the ladder takes us to a greater distance. But how do we calibrate the cosmic distance ladder? We first need absolute methods that give us absolute distance measurements. So first, absolute distance estimators. We use simple geometric techniques as absolute distance estimators. The available methods includes, for example, the trigonometric parallax. Let's see how the trigonometric parallax method works. As the Earth revolves around the Sun, the point from which we see the stars continually changes. Thus, their apparent directions also change a bit. We can measure this change in position and write, where W is half of the angle of variation of the star's position over the year, measured in arc seconds. The W angle is also called the parallax. This method comes from geometric considerations, so it's an absolute calibrator. If we can measure the W angle, we are able to determine the distance of our object. Problems start to arise when we are considering very distant stars for which we aren't able to determine the parallax because it is too slight and we don't have the right instruments to measure that little shift in position. The larger known parallax is 0.75 arcseconds for Alpha Centauri, which places it at a distance of 1.3 parsecs, making it our nearest star. To make sense of our accuracy in calibrating the distance ladder, we need some other absolute methods. If we know a star's radius, for example, then we can estimate its distance from us. This is made possible by the Baud-Westlink method. From its optical color or spectral type, we can measure the effective temperature of the star. Its intrinsic luminosity is then given by L is equal to C times R squared times T to the fourth. By comparing the apparent magnitude of the star to its absolute magnitude, we have a direct measurement of the star's distance from us. Unfortunately, it is not usually possible to measure stellar radii directly, but we can overcome the problem studying variables such as Cepheids and R Lyra. Second step, lines in the spectrum of such a variable star show Doppler shifts that vary cyclically with the same period as the star's brightness variations. These variations arise because the atmosphere of the star is unstable and undergoes global expansion and contraction, changing the size of the star. Studies conducted have given us a well-defined relationship between the star's period and its intrinsic luminosity. P is proportional to L. That is, the brighter the star, the longer the period. So, now that we know the star's intrinsic luminosity, we can use the so-called distance module that will give us the distance of the star. A similar approach is used with the RR Lyra stars. Old population stars with a smaller period and fainter than Cepheids. Cepheids and RR Lyra are called primary estimators in order to distinguish them from the absolute estimators. Third step, secondary distance estimators. There are a lot of secondary estimators that astronomers use to estimate the distance of a faraway object. But the most efficient one is the Type 1A supernovae. What's a Type 1A supernova? A Type 1 supernova is a type of supernova that occurs in binary systems, two stars orbiting one another, in which one of the stars is a white dwarf. The other star can be anything from a giant star to an even smaller white dwarf. Physically, carbon-oxygen white dwarfs with a low rate of rotation are limited to below 1.44 solar masses. Beyond this critical mass, they reignite and in some cases trigger a supernova explosion. The Type 1A category of supernova produces a fairly consistent peak luminosity because of this fixed critical mass at which a white dwarf will explode. Their consistent peak luminosity allows these explosions to be used as standard candles to measure the distance to their host galaxies. The visual magnitude of a Type 1A supernova, as observed from Earth, indicates its distance from Earth. But how do we do that? Studying Type 1A supernovae at a known distance, astronomers found that the luminosity peak is the same for almost all of them, so that, from the distance module, we can estimate their distance. Type 1A supernovae provides us with the distances for objects that reach 100 megaparsecs, which makes them one of the most powerful distance estimators. Of course, we are not done with all the secondary distance estimators. For example, we can say that the same empiric laws, Tully-Fisher relation, Faber-Jackson relation, exist that can give us the distance for distant objects. But we needed to talk about the Type 1A supernovae because they are very bright and help astronomers calculating the Hubble constant. In fact, when we reach the top of the distance ladder, we understand that there is a connection between the shift in spectral lines of an object and its distance from us. This crucial cosmological result was originally obtained without good absolute distance calibration. The first one who makes an attempt to understand how things work was Edwin Hubble, an American astronomer. Following on from the discovery that the characteristic lines in the spectra of almost all galaxies are shifted systematically toward the red by Slipher in 1914, Hubble investigated the relationship between the distance d to a galaxy and the amount that a line of intrinsic wavelength is shifted in its spectrum. Hubble provided evidence that this recessional velocity of a galaxy increases with its distance from the Earth, a property known as Hubble's law. despite the fact that it had been both proposed and demonstrated observationally 2 years earlier by Georges Lemaître. The Hubble-Lemaître law implies that the universe is expanding and the recession of the galaxies gives rise to their redshift via the usual Doppler formula. Let's write down Hubble's law. V equals H of O times D, where V is the speed of separation and H of O is the Hubble's constant. Running the clock backwards, we can see that one Hubble time, the inverse of H of zero, is equal to D over V ago, all the galaxies must have started from the same place. This is how we set the cosmology introducing a Big Bang at a finite time in the past, when all the universe was concentrated in a small volume. That's why it is so important to determine a reliable value of the Hubble constant. It gives us an estimate of the age of the universe. We made a huge effort to estimate H of O, and the accepted value for it is today somewhere between 65 and 75 kilometers per second per megaparsecs, although its estimate is still uncertain. Type 1 supernovae, with their brightness, are very well visible and can help us covering very long distances, and thus have a better estimate of the Hubble's constant. Also, it should be said that the more distant we go, the less error we have on the V value. That's why type 1a supernovae are important to astronomers. We made a long way through the universe today, and we are happy of that. But we would be happier if you thought that this video was useful to you. Every time, we hope so. This video ends here. Thanks for watching, everyone. Are you happy with the choice of the Nobel Prize winners? What would you ask them? Which discoveries do you think should be awarded the Nobel Prize in the future? Let us know in the comments below. See you on the channel.